My name is Ellyn Norris, and I'm a senior faculty member with AIP Online. And I'd like to share with you my experiences and my directions in my travel to Iceland in June of 2013. Just a little bit about me first. I'm from Halifax, Nova Scotia, Canada, and I've been living in San Diego since 2000. And I studied photography from a fine art perspective. So although I do some commercial work and teaching, my background is fine art and even sculpture and painting and drawing, whatever I need to kind of express my, you know, my ideas and my concepts. I've been teaching at AI schools since 2001 in San Diego and then online since 2003. I have commercial clients and do sell my fine art prints. And my website is ellynism.com. Okay, so first off, let me go back because it skipped a little bit. Okay, so for my Iceland trip intentions, what I intended to go there for a month for June 2013 is to learn more about DSLR video and audio on location shooting and editing, because I can share all that experiences with students and get better at it myself. And what better place to go, one that is a little bit challenging in terms of landscape, wind, and light, and weather. So I also had intentions to complete a landscape photography project, and the check marks are showing you which ones that I have completed. I wanted to have a photo exhibition well in Iceland that supports diversity and my integration with the culture, which I did. And I wanted to have a solo exhibition at the AICASD campus to promote the new photography program there. I'm doing that now. My show opened last month and it runs until October 31st. I also wanted to learn salsa dancing from Icelandic people, but not on the original proposal, but I also learned to do that. Why Iceland? I mean, looking at this little map, I call it the snowflake island in the North Country. I was really interested in a lot of points of Iceland, the supernatural beauty, the culture there. I found really interesting. The more research I did, the more I really wanted to go there. So my initial time there was to explore and photograph examples of faith in the landscape. I've been working on a book, a photo book, for several years now, and the reason it's taking several years is it's requiring me to travel to different countries in the world. And the book is kind of a dedication to my parents, who are both passed on. And my mother was a Roman Catholic nun who was a very devout Catholic. And at the same time, my dad was native Canadian, had native heritage. And he was the one that taught me about nature and fishing and hunting and just to appreciate nature. So the book is kind of a combination of a King Solomon quote, "To let heaven and nature sing." So I've been a lot of places in the world, a lot of Asian countries too, and these are some examples of places I visited. This is the Tiger's Nest in Paro, Bhutan, which is in the Himalayas. And yes, I had to climb up all the way to get down to that temple, which it was a feat in itself with the altitude there. The bottom one is Bhutanath, which is in Kathmandu. It's the world's largest Buddha stupa. And then this is on an island in the Philippines. It's a little Mary grotto I found on a beach in an island called Boracay. So this is kind of a preliminary idea of where I came from before Iceland. And what pulled me to Iceland was not only is the architecture interesting, but there are also many natural formations that seem to mimic religious iconography. So here's me in 2012 during my first trip to Iceland, where I was really concentrating on capturing both the Christian architecture and their churches, but also how the landscape kind of, you know, through lava formations, were able to give the idea of and relate to religious past in architecture. So the one on the bottom right is a natural rock formation in Mývat in the north, where it looks like a cathedral archway. And what you can't tell from this particular photo is the scale, like you can walk in and out, and the other side also has a cathedral type of roof, which is kind of cool. The one on the top right is a church, the major church in Reykjavik, which is the capital of Iceland, and the one with me in it is a little church up in the north as well, Icelandic people lived in mud houses for many years, and their churches were mud churches where they'd have grass on top and hay and mud, and that would keep them insulated. Here's an example of another rock formation in Iceland in the south that they call the cathedral floor. And as you can see, the lava, the way it cooled, kind of looks like and mimics kind of a mosaic on the floor there. And this is just in the middle of a field, and someone has a little house back there. So kind of interesting to explore different ideas in there. So a few facts about Iceland to tell you. They have a population of approximately 320,000 people. The closest land mass to Iceland, on the southeast side anyway, is northern Scotland. And it's true, Iceland is green and Greenland's ice. They speak three languages fluently. They learn Icelandic, which is the kind of a northern Germanic language. They also speak Danish and English by the time they finish high school at age 20. They boast having the purest breed of horses in the world with a fifth gate called Tolting. And what that means to anybody who likes cars is like driving a Lamborghini. It's got another gear in there. Many Icelandic words cannot be translated into one word in other languages. For example, the word jokul means a snow-covered volcano. How can we actually say that one word in our language? We can't. So there's a lot of words there that relate to the landscape and the natural, you know, the supernaturalness of the place that are just one word and not translated in other languages. An Icelandic last name is dependent on your father's first name. So my Icelandic last name is John's daughter. My father's name is John, so I'm John's daughter. And my brother's last name would be Johnson. So that's where, if you've ever seen those last names before, they've come from Icelandic background. And an Icelandic philosophy is there are no problems, only solutions. And I thought that was a beautiful part about my experience in integrating with the people there and making friends, is that they had a very positive spirit. And I think it comes from living in the north and having kind of a tough climate where half the year it's pretty dark, like only a few hours of light during the winter, and then it gets light 100% of the time, like when I was there in June. So the people are very resilient and very positive. To prepare for my trip there in this time around, I believe in a term called planned spontaneity. And that's it's a term by David Duchaimon, who's a humanitarian photographer I admire. And it really makes sense when you think about it. As much of the planning and research you can do ahead of time as an on-location photographer will allow you to be able to be spontaneous when you're there. So if you've got the gear covered, you've got the weather covered, you've got your maps, you've got, you know, perfect light and perfect locations, you can go with what happens. So keep that in mind as photographers, something called planned spontaneity. I think it's key and crucial in going somewhere photographing new kind of sites and subjects. Another thing I did was I needed to test out and purchase any new gear for my required projects. And I practiced shooting and recording to work out any kinks. And I completed tutorials and worked on mini projects in Premiere and Logic Pro. Premiere is the video program, and Logic Pro is the sound software that I used. Before I left, too, I came across in my research the top right image of an Icelandic woman on her Icelandic horse with her Icelandic sheepdog. And I was really intrigued by this image. And I tried to put myself in her spirit, and thinking about what she was thinking and how wonderful it would be to, you know, explore the landscape there on horseback. So I happened to ride Icelandic horses. So the bottom left image is one I set up, and my friend, who owns a lot of Icelandic horses here in San Diego, helped me take the shot. And that's her Icelandic sheepdog named Bossy. And I got to tell you, this shot was hard to get. You have to shoot in continuous mode, people, because to get me straight, the horse head straight and looking proper, and the dog in the scene was not an easy feat. But my idea was to kind of take that original top right image, you know, improve the composition a little bit. I wouldn't cut off horses' feet like the snapshot at the top. And find an area of northern San Diego that could be kind of like the scrublands of Iceland. So that would be my current emulation self-portrait. So let's get on to Iceland. I arrived in Iceland on June 1st of this year, and if we go back to the map, I was in Reykjavik on the bottom left where my cursor is, and the areas I covered were the Reykjavik area and inland here, where there's some famous waterfalls and parks that are key to visit. There's a place called the Golden Circle, which everybody travels to. But a lot of people don't travel to other areas of Iceland, so it was really important for me to do that. So I spent some time in Snæfellsnes, which is up here. This is a small glacier, but it has historic value to them. They think aliens came through this little glacier in this tip here. So this area is very rugged and really good food, nice coastline. Then I traveled up through Borgarnes, up to Skagafjordur. I went to Akureyri a couple of times, up to Húsavík, Mývatn. I'm learning the language along the way, Dettifoss, which you'll see in some of my images and video. I went up to something called Aspergi, which is kind of the Grand Canyon of Iceland. I came down the east in this area, which is my favorite area. It's the most remote. I went to Seyðisfjörður, which is too small for this map, which is a fjord town. I went to Hope. I went to all this area in the south, Skaftafell. This is a huge glacier area, all the way down to this long name that I can't even pronounce. I don't even think the locals pronounce it. They call it Clouster instead of all these other letters before Clouster. And then I also went to Vik several times, and up through these areas in the glaciers. So do I want to go back? Absolutely. The western fjords are my next focus, which is up here, and it's supposed to be the most authentic and beautiful area in some ways. I think the whole thing is interesting, the whole island, and you know, one of their sayings is if you don't like the landscape, drive 10 minutes because it changes so drastically throughout. So here's me at Dettifoss. Actually, that's Selfoss in the background, a smaller one leading up to Dettifoss. And if anyone listening has seen the movie Prometheus, it's the opening waterfall, like at the opening of the movie you see there. I was lucky to have some sisters visit me and my family, so they were able to take some kind of candid photos of me at work. The bottom pano is an image in an area on the east side. That's my favorite one. This is such a remote area. There's a little dirt road, if you can see to the left. And this waterfall is kind of unnamed. It's just there, and you can drink from the streams. I actually fell into this river and saved my 5D. I had it up in my other hand. My knee wasn't saved 100%, but it was worth it to me not to wreck my camera. So rugged terrain and very pristine. Here's another shot that my sister took of me in an area called Jökulsárnin, which you'll see. It's an iceberg lake. All the ice is breaking off the glacier up here. And the turquoise ice flows mean they actually are newer. They have been released a lot just recently because they don't have the same amount of oxygen in the snow and the ice. So the turquoise means newer breakoffs. I've also, to integrate in the culture in Iceland, I met a commercial affiliate that I worked with called Friend in Iceland. And if you're on Facebook, you can look at Friend in Iceland page and like it if you like, you know, if you want to hear more about tourism there. The shot on the left I took for one of their glacier tours. The one on the right is one they used for me with me in their brochures showing they do photo excursions for photographers. And I got to drive that beefy truck through rivers and stuff, so it was a lot of fun hanging out with local people, helping them with their goals in business, and then also I got free tours and food along the way and got to see some country that I may not have been able to see without them. So these are some of my friends in the top left corner that work for Friends in Iceland or are friends of Friends in Iceland. So, and we had a video crew with us that day that was helping them to promote their work as well. The bottom right is a group of trolls I met. Iceland has lots of interesting folklore with trolls and elves and so on. And that's an example of, you know, kind of some fun location attractions in a northern town called Akureyri, which is a ski town. I also tried to integrate with artists and photo artists over there, and this particular artist, his name is Spessy Halberson, and he's an interesting fellow. He just got back from living in Kansas for a year, and where he photographed the biker culture, the gun and biker culture in Kansas in the Midwest. If you're interested in seeing his work, his site is www.spessy.com. And this is a shot of us in the gallery in the Museum of Photography in Reykjavik, where he had a solo exhibition. And he was so kind to meet me for coffee and look at my work that was hanging. And he also took me on a personal tour of his work. So a very modest culture and very connected with people and willing to give you the time. You know, if you ask them, they're pretty kind. So that's Fessy. I was also able to take some environmental portraiture and work on that with my friends. The man on the top right is John, and he is a high jump champion, world champion, and he's still high jumping. I think he's one of the world's oldest high jumpers, too, and he still competes on an international level. The bottom left is my salsa dancing instructor partner, Christian. And this is an example of how he likes to hike, which is just lay around in a field. The bottom right is Gunnar Sigurdsson, who's kind of a famous Icelandic person who, when the economy crashed there, he made a very famous documentary on the country's state at that point. And he's the one who owns Friend in Iceland, and he wanted a portrait with Urifoss, which is, this is the highest yielding waterfall in Iceland. It's not the most, you know, kind of dramatic one, as you'll see. They're way more dramatic. But there's a lot of controversy around this particular waterfall at this point. They're wanting to harvest the energy of these falls to produce electricity to run an aluminum plant. And there's a huge kind of clash between progress and also keeping the beautiful nature that's in Iceland. They have one aluminum plant at this point. It's a bit of an eyesore in a fjord town, and so the people aren't 100% buying it. And I kind of agree, because what they have is their beauty, and their economy is based on tourism and will continue to grow. So that's something that we'll see in the future, maybe change or not. But either way, Gunnar, this is him posing, and you can see how small he is compared to the huge waterfall. Okay, so I had to rent an apartment in Reykjavik because that's where I was mainly at. I did travel the island twice completely around and go, but I needed a home base. So I just wanted to show you this little kind of cute apartment that I had with the red door. And this is at midnight, about mid-June. And so it'll show you how beautiful the light is all day long. The sun goes down barely and comes back up at that time of day. Also, this is a cabin that I stayed in when I was in East Iceland, and that's close to midnight as well. And just a very quaint country in every way, very clean, very efficient, and a lot of interesting places to go. Lots of interesting food to eat. The top left is Gull, one of their beers, their draft beer, and fish and chips, and then the right, of course, beautiful sushi. So I had fun eating seafood at least once or twice a day, and the lamb is incredible there too. Happy lambs come from Iceland. It wouldn't be Ellyn without showing you some of the horses, because that's one of the magical reasons I returned there. They're completely different than any other breed on this earth. They've lived in Iceland 1,000 years with no predators. So they're very relaxed horses compared to other breeds. So they are known to pass out in the middle of the field, and you kind of have to yell at them to get them up. They fall fast asleep. They also have no problem putting 40 horses together in one area. They don't kick or bite very often. I've never seen one kick. Some are a bit of biters once in a while. They tend to be heady horses, but it's more like they want to come in for a cuddle versus bite you. So very friendly horses. when I was up in the north, I saw these people getting ready to ride, and they were like, yeah, we're going up in the glaciers for a 7-day trip. So they allowed me to go up the road a little bit so I could capture some of the images when they let the horses go, which was kind of cool. And then some of them stayed behind, and we actually went for a ride, my daughter, my husband, and I. And so very friendly and adaptable people and accommodating. Here's a couple examples of me and the horses. Top right, a little filly that was born, you know, maybe a couple of weeks before this was taken. And the mom was so kind to, and not protective, to allow me to, you know, kind of go up to the little filly and say hi. And there's me on Bina, which is like a little red rocket. And we took a trip up to some waterfalls way in the back. And I got to tell you, this is the slowest or the stillest the horse was the entire time I was on her. So you can see they're really tiny. They're small but mighty, but very fast and very efficient. And then Grauman, my favorite one, and I always say that he's the closest I will ever get to riding a unicorn, because his tolt is almost like you're on clouds, riding on clouds. Very cool. So if you ever get an opportunity to ride an Icelandic horse, do it for sure. So my show, excuse some of the pictures here, I didn't take them because I was in them, but I had a show at a local cafe called Cafe Haiti. A woman from Haiti married an Icelandic man, and she opened a cafe on the harborfront downtown Reykjavik. So they have a lot of art shows at this gallery that are ongoing, and then of course there's other commercial galleries there, but with the type of notice I had to put something together, this was an ideal spot for sure, and they were great to support me. On the top right are my favorite people in Iceland. I call her Thura, my Icelandic sister, and her husband Friedrich. And on the bottom left is me and my daughter, who came to Iceland for the opening and fell in love and plans to go to university there when she graduates high school. And then on the bottom right, I did a lot of helicopter work when I was there. This is my helicopter pilot, so he came to see my show. My current show at the Art Institute of California, San Diego, this is a digital invitation for it, has been going on for since September 16th. And here's where you get to see me integrating my photo with portraiture in this case. I created three grids that I'm going to show you that compare nature to humans and human scars. So the first grid here we could look at is a student at my current school, and he's came back from Afghanistan in quite bad shape. He had lost a leg, a part of another leg, and part of his face. And what I love about him is so resilient and really open, and he was actually one of the most fun people I ever had in a studio for a portrait shoot. I've got some kind of cool shots of him you know, just goofing around as well. But I wanted to concentrate. This is his face. He had a hip kind of graph, and it looked like a heart. So I thought that was kind of interesting. Part of his legs in different areas, scars on his arm, and then his amputated leg. So my idea is with these grids, and these are 36 inches by 36. So each of these images are 6 inches each. There are 36 of them. Are kind of aimed to take away the pain factor. And I think the big difference between looking at knots in trees and in rock formations is we don't think of the pain associated with scars in nature. So I wanted to show enough of different and variations within imperfections, I guess some people call them, and kind of show different scale references. For instance, this was taken from a helicopter, this was taken from a helicopter, this one was from a helicopter, and this one, but then some are close up. Here's a horse hoof, and I have horse fur and moss and tree bark close up. So just to get rid of the scale idea so that we can look at human scars in a more objective way, I guess. So that would be one, and that's the Cody grid. This next one is a grid dedicated to Jennifer, who's a friend of mine, and she had scoliosis when she was young. So these are x-rays. I've made positives of x-rays of the screws that they had to put in her back. You can even see the spinal cord and everything in here, along with the scars that were left across her hip and back and into her stomach. And Shriners approached her a couple of years after her surgery and were willing to pay for her, like for laser scar removal. And she didn't go for that. She said, no, I own these scars. Now, I always thought that was a really wonderful thing for her to be 16 and such an old soul in a way and decide, no, these are a part of who I am and I'm going to live with them. And in fact, story about Jen, she got married on Saturday with an open back dress. So this grid is dedicated to her. And once again, I've incorporated some close-ups, some helicopter views, some beach views, lava flows, everything to kind of work around and give you different experiences in these characteristics and qualities without associating too much. The last grid, and I will continue to build these grids, have a couple of different people in them. This is my sister who received a black eye when she visited me in Iceland. She had an unfortunate smash into a spa door, a glass door at a spa. Here I'm taking her to the spa to relax, and she gets a door in the face. So it caused her eye to go purple, and I was like, thank you, you've given me more material. So this is my sister. I also have my daughter's back. Something she hates is her moles, and I thought, okay, let's just compare it to other areas of little details, and let's see how they get lost. The top right and bottom left is a friend of mine who was in a Cuban detention camp and received a wound. And when he was on a boat coming to the U.S., he almost lost his hand because it was getting infected, like at his wrist. And a woman on the boat used fishing line and fixed it for him. And, he kept his hand, which is good, in his wrist. And that's in a kind of integration of a tattoo that he put along, which is a famous Cuban official that's in there. So so I mixed it up. In this case, the grid contains images from Canada. From this one's from San Juan, Puerto Rico, if you recognize the cathedral floor from Iceland. I have a little bit of Montreal in here and a little bit of some of Canadian bark in there and birch tree. And this is a part of a skull from Pompeii. I'm a victim in Pompeii. So lots of different things in there. So those are my three grids that are featured in the show. I also have some larger 13 by 19 prints, which show some of the grids entirely. I really like looking at the texture and detail and how sometimes you can't tell the scale, like how close I am to it. And I really think mixing up scale and perspective changes us. It really makes us look at things in different ways. The bottom right is a lava flow from a recent volcano explosion. If you've heard of the eruption of Eyjafjallajökull, which means island mountain glacier, that stopped air traffic in Northern Europe for a while, this is it. This is the results. These beautiful lava flows that almost look like veins and arteries, I thought. And this is a pier where water is dependent on what's below. So this is the color of the water and how the light hit it. As with these ones, I also like to compare. This was taken from like a helicopter, and this was taken up close on a moss on a rock. So I like to look at forms and how we can see them in large scale versus small scale as an artist. And that's something I've always been interested in, comparisons and science and how we collect things and so on. So this is just really an extension of work I've been doing for years. I also had four feature landscape photos in the gallery. They're 24 by 36 prints in 30 by 40 frames matted. And all four of them are kind of features of the video I'm going to show you in a while, which is on the movement of water in Iceland. So they all kind of mirror the idea of water and how really different it is there. In this case, I was driving down the main road in the south, and I came across, this kind of mud flats with a stream going. If you look at the far, the kind of skyline you'll see a black sand, and that's like a 5 kilometer wide black sand beach. And then there was rain dancing along here. So I took still images and video of this particular scene. Here's a shot also featured large, and this is of the icebergs in the iceberg lake. Also lots of moving water. And this one of the shoreline of Daddy Foss. I didn't want to necessarily show the rigorous movement of the waterfall in these images. I was looking more for abstractions and scale, maybe scale confusion a little bit. For instance, in this shot, you would be as smaller than this boulder over here in the snow. So the idea of immense scale, and they really make a difference to see them large in the gallery. And then the final one is one I took from the helicopter facing kind of going towards south light. And the black sand was able to create all these colors in the sand. Now, I enhanced this a little bit, but not a lot. This is what I captured, essentially. I just fixed it up a little bit in Photoshop. But that's what it looks like. So very supernatural. So those four are the feature larger images. And of course, no show of mine, once again, is complete without putting some horses. So this one I call Tina Turner Horse, and this was a horse I photographed in Snæfellsnes area, West Iceland, as well as this is in West Iceland, just to show the camaraderie amongst the horses, that they hang out and kiss each other. And I chose this photo because I really liked the foreground and how one was passing by me and the little tail kind of blowing in the wind. This I had good light in the shot too, I thought. You don't always get that there. So the takeaways from my trip. I decided I need even more time there. I've been in a lot of countries in the world, but I really have an affinity to the place. In fact, people think I'm Icelandic because I kind of look it, and I love to learn the language. I also learned there are always kinks to work out. So no matter how much I planned ahead of time with gear and practice, there was always things that came up during on-location photography, and you kind of have to think on your feet and just be, smart about it. For instance, one day I forgot my neutral density filters. Okay, I got to stack some more polarizers. so you've got to think on your feet and be open to working with different possibilities. So always kinks to work out. Weather can be challenging despite having light 24/7 in June. I had a lot of rain the first couple of weeks, but it improved. The north was very sunny, so when I'd hear the north would be sunny, I'd try to spend more time up there. You can't always chase the sun, though. I know that because it is a fair distance. It takes about 5 to 6 days to get around the entire island, so it takes a while. I also learned that I'm a photographer, videographer first, and editor dead last. I got some help with my final editing in terms of time and input because I've had, the toughest part I learned about video is going through all your footage and deciding kind of what you're going to use and what you're not going to use and kind of putting it in some sort of order for sequences. And I can effectively do that for sure now. And I'm working on, effects and editing. But I think if you gave me a job, I definitely would be the person, send me even out in the rain with my camera and my gear. And I would rather have that role if I had to choose versus an editor. I also really enjoyed capturing audio and sound there. It really made me look at things differently around me, like potential noise issues coming up when I'm recording and so on. So audio is interesting work in itself as well. And I also learned that initially my idea for the title, The Beauty of Perspective, was focused on the photo grids. But now I see it suiting my entire Icelandic experience. As artists and educators, I see changing our perspectives as a beautiful thing. And we really do have to get out of our norm and try some different things. And I feel very fortunate to have been able to do that as long as I did. And one last fact I want to leave you with on Iceland, and I want to ask you how you find your way out of an Icelandic forest. And of course, you're all muted, so you can't answer. So I'll answer it for you. You stand up. Because Iceland doesn't have many trees at all, let alone tall trees. So how you get out, how do you find your way out? You stand up. Ha ha, I'll laugh for you. And finally, I wanted to, before you see my video, I wanted to show you a little Icelandic salsa. I am serious. I did take salsa lessons, and this is an example of a little vignette of Thursday night salsa that I experienced. And look at the light outside. This is at 10:30 at night. So that's my PowerPoint. I can answer any questions at the end, but the first thing I have a 5-minute video. So I'd like to ask you all to make sure that your volume is up a little bit while I play it. This is about 5 minutes, and if you can get into the vibe and kind of chill out and listen to the sounds and the music selection along with the images, I hope it can be relaxing for you and take you on a tour of some of the areas I visited. Essentially, what you're going to see in the video, I start in the North Country at clockwise at Dedi Foss, and I work my way clockwise all around the island from the east to the south to the west and back up north again. So you're going to see quite a bit, and I call this the movement of water. Thank you. Okay, so that's my video, and I would really like to offer anyone to ask me any questions at this point about my work and about my experience. Mary, do you want to go ahead and be the mediator in that case?
Yes, Ellyn, we actually have quite a few questions that have already come in during your talk, so I'm just going to kind of randomly go through the list. We've got some great questions. First of all, Charles McNeary says, I'm intrigued with your incorporating human scars with nature. What inspired you to create the comparison of features? He also takes similar photographs of nature but never thought of looking at humans before and creating stills.
Yeah, that is a good question I touched on, but I would have to say what intrigued me was meeting people that had particular scars and scar stories, and they were all different, and people tend to kind of, either be embarrassed for their scars or be proud of them, and just meeting people. And one day it dawned on me, because once again, I've been obsessed even with my sculpture work with kind of comparing in a scientific way. It dawned on me, this scar in the tree kind of looks like, this mole on someone's arm, and this scar kind of looks like a scar a human could have on a tree. So I thought, okay, let's explore it. And my idea in the grids is not to kind of disguise it or hide the actual scars. It's the idea that they can be standing out distinct, like all the different kind of characteristics in the rocks and trees amongst the scars. But the idea of perspective and how the way we look at things and compare things kind of changes our view. So that's kind of how I went with that. I'm also love abstraction in nature, and I think with people we're nature as well. So abstraction in people is kind of an interesting area to explore.
Okay, great. Deanna Porter asks a technical question. How often did you have to diffuse the lighting conditions to obtain the right exposures? The areas where her question's a little bit longer. The areas where you look like the perfect conditions for shooting these nature shots, and what was the temperature like while you were there?
Oh, okay. Well, first off, there's a difference between shooting video and still photography. You have a lot more play when it comes to still photography than video. With video, it's really important to carry neutral density filters that darken your lens because you're shooting at 1/50 of a second. And it's actually not good in video to go too low with your ISO. So if you're shooting at 200 or 160 ISO at 50th of a second, your f-stop range shouldn't really be that high either. I kind of experimented, but generally, from people that I've studied under, generally stay between 3.5, 5.6 for a certain cinematic look. At some points, I had no choice but to go up to as high as f9. And I was okay with a lot of the results. lighting is a challenge. It's also physically challenging to worry about whether you're going to get rained on in different areas, because the weather does change. It's and you know, you can't predict a day. If you don't like the weather, wait 10 minutes. So that was an issue. It was just a lot of patience. You got to be patient and you got to wait for it. And you've got to be with people. If you go with people at all, you got to be with people that are patient as well, and they know your focus. And I was really happy to be with my sisters and a friend, because they were looking for me, and they were like, you know, such great assistance, and really, you know, got into my work as well and very helpful. So if you travel with people, they need to know your priority is to get the shots, and they need to be patient. Absolutely. Another thing is during the summer, there's no such thing as like the magic hour at one particular time of day. But I would say the second last waterfall I showed, Selfoss, I shot at 9:30 at night, because I found that was almost like my magic hour at that particular time of the year. So you have to be open with that. What was the last part of that question, Mary?
The temperature. What was the temperature like?
Oh, the temperature. Yes, I knew I missed something. The temperature is actually not bad in Iceland. The south is a pretty temperate place. It never snows in the south. It snows in the mountains, but in the southern area, they rarely get snow. It could stay around 11 degrees Celsius, which, let me just add quickly, 50s, 40s, 50s in Fahrenheit. When I was there, it depends where you are. In the highlands up in the north, it can be so windy that bikers have to be careful, like cyclists like to cycle that area, but there's winds that come up that are so, it's a high desert. The north part of Iceland. It's weird, but it's a high desert climate. So the wind can whip so fast, it can remove the paint off your car. So you've got to be careful with wind. I've been there when it's been colder, but the black sand in different areas reflects light, absorbs the light, and warms the areas. So in the iceberg shots you've seen, that day was a glorious day. It was 20 degrees Celsius, which is, 70s, in the 70s down there. So it wasn't so bad. You see me in different clothes and different shots. Generally, a down vest was a good way to go, because I had good movability with my arms, and it just kept my core warm. And when you hike, too, like I've had to hike into these sites, you get warm, too. So generally not too cold. But you have to like layer, and I had about 3 different jackets and sweaters in the car, and hats and shoes and boots. So
great. David Gaston wants to know a question about when you're traveling to your destination as a landscape photographer. How do you get your point of contact before you get there?
Well, I find research a really good thing, and writing people and talking to friends. Like Thura, my Icelandic sister, was actually a good friend of mine from Canada, had gone there and worked with her. She was a flight attendant, and he's a flight attendant. So they met. So meeting people through people, anyone you know have been to this area before. Facebook's great for looking up pages. I found Friend in Iceland on Facebook, and ended up being able to meet them over there and hang out with them. Just being a friendly person and being really genuinely interested in the culture you're traveling to, you get so much from the people. And that goes with anywhere I traveled. Everybody is proud of where they're from, often very willing to share ideas, resources, and locations. So it helps to be friendly and open, and I find that's what has worked for me in planning my trips.
Okay. Michael Stallmaker asks, how long does it take you to complete one of your projects usually?
Well, this project in particular, like the grids, I created a template as a PSD file. So that takes a little bit of time. Playing around with the abstractions, of course, I'm a full frame girl. I love to show full frame, and my large prints are all full frame. So cropping takes a while, deciding on crops. So I would say one grid, like in laying it out digitally, could take a couple of days, a couple hours a day for a while to get it where I want it to be. And then, of course, getting set to print, it is a little bit more time, doing test prints and mounting. And so an entire project, you know, I started this the end of March, and my show opened in September. But, of course, I have a life and a job in between that time.
Okay. Deanna Porter asks, were the Icelandic people very willing to have their photos taken, or were they leery? Do you have any, or do they have any beliefs that prevent them from letting you shoot their photo?
I would say that is dependent on the person. My people, like who I hang with, they really are super okay, especially guys, and girls are fine. But I would say Western culture, and I base this being Canadian as well, we're a lot more kind of suspicious when when someone takes our photo, because we're like, where are we going to end up? Like, are we going to be on Facebook? Are we going to be on Flickr and Instagram and so on? So we tend to be a little bit more guarded when it comes to it. I think Icelandic people, like, if they knew the intentions of what you're taking, I think they'd be very open to be photographed. But of course, that's based on the individual there as well.
And Ellyn, so just because we have several equipment and tech questions coming through here, could you repeat the camera you're using for both photo and video again? There's lots of cameras.
Certainly, and there's good learning in there too. I shoot with a 5D Mark II, and I brought along a Canon SL1, like the new lightest, smallest DSLR Canon as an extra camera, and that was certainly good to take around to clubs and stuff. There's quite a nightlife in Iceland too. I didn't want to have to drag my big camera there. But I like a full sensor, like I'm all about that. I came from that world, and I have to stay in that world. So I shoot with a full sensor camera, some of the lenses I used a 70-300 L series lens, which I love. I'm not a huge zoom person, like telephoto zoom, but it's needed in landscapes like this where you physically can't get places, so you need to get closer, and you need a good zoom. Like a good telephoto lens to do that. I also have an 85 millimeter f/1.8, which I shot the horses with that you saw. I also have a nifty 50 1.4 that is great for a lot of different shooting as well. And I have a 24-105, which is a good kind of versatile lens, especially with video, because, you know, the low f-stop isn't an issue. And it's a decent range to work with in video. So that's kind of my gear. One of the most important things you can pick out as a video person is a tripod. So I have a carbon tripod, so it's light, but at the same time, it has a little hook in the bottom, in the middle, that I could put like a bag of rocks on if I need to, because wind is an issue there. Or I'd hook my gear bag to the hook. Anything to kind of weight it down a little bit more. And then I have a little doohickey, I'm forgetting the name now, but it's essentially a part of the head of the tripod that allows me to maneuver the camera to be level, even if my legs aren't level. So that I found to be invaluable on the trip, especially you look at the terrain I've covered, you know, you're not going to get an even surface very often. And of course, neutral density filters. I tend to buy the largest diameter neutral density and buy step down rings for the other lenses. And I'm going to buy a variable neutral density filter after I pay off this trip completely. So I think that would be a really good thing to use as video.
Well, that brings me to another question. You mentioned the finances. Several people had questions about how you finance a trip like this and what you need to do to kind of prepare for this financially.
Well, that's a really practical question. From the Art Institute of California, San Diego, I was given a sabbatical. So I was on leave and I was paid leave, which is kind of a good thing, because when you're off a month, that's a lot of pay missing. So that helped. I was able to take vacation with the online from my online position. So my salary was still being paid, which is big. to save up the money, I guess a lot of my teaching assignments and selling of my prints and doing commercial work went towards my trip. Sharing a place, like having people travel with you, is always a lot cheaper than having going by yourself. So that's a good thing too. And then also for plane fare, knowing when you're going ahead of time and watching the airfares and, you know, going on kayak and having flight alerts to, you know, be economical with your flights, that's key too. So I have lots of ways of cutting corners and kind of saving up. And then sometimes you just have to take a risk. I'm at an age and time in my life where I feel like I have to do that. And so that's kind of how I do it. Bring a lot of power bars, you know, so, and cook at home when you're somewhere else. Like, there's ways of cutting corners. If you really want something, if you really want to go somewhere, you can do it. And I've done Asia a lot cheaper than Iceland. Iceland's Northern Europe. It's an expensive country. And, you know, everything's got to be shipped there pretty much in a lot of cases. So, but depending on where you go, the costs are going to be more. I will say that.
Eric Keith has a follow-up on your neutral density filter information. He wants to know, does that include using a polarization filter?
Well, sometimes I doubled it up. I don't know if it's a good idea, you know, but at some points I had to double up my polarizers with the neutral density filters because it was bright. So I think everything's a bit of testing in that way. You can also stack extra neutral density filters. So you don't have to do, like, there's three times, like you can do two, three times darkener. So there's a lot of different ways you can work with it. I'd say start with one. If you can invest in a variable kit, that's probably the best way, route to go. And just, you know, go with your exposure knowledge based on still photography when it comes to metering. Like all these, the shots that you saw in the video, they weren't, like, I did a bit of color grading and not much exposure change though. So that was kind of where I was most proud, because I was able to meter pretty well and get good exposures based on being a still photographer and apply that knowledge to the video work.
Thanks, Ellyn. Hillary Osborne wants to know if you use strictly natural light or do you substitute with strobes and hot lights or supplement?
Well, sometimes speed lights come in handy depending on the work I do. But in Iceland, it was all natural light. It was kind of, and even the grids, it was all natural light because that was kind of my goal. It was to use available natural light in this project.
So we've got several lens questions. Which lenses did you use on your trip? Was it the same one, or did you use a combination of different lenses?
Yeah, I had mentioned the lenses I have in my bag. I have 85 1.8, a 50 1.4. These are all Canon L series, a 70 to 300, and then I have a 24 to 105. So four lenses. And how I, you know, depending on the space, I would tend to use, you know, different ones. And I'm a Canon shooter. I mean, it's not always about, you know, your brand. It's, you know, it's your vision and it's your technique that's important. But I tend to side on Canon at this particular time.
And what would you recommend? Michelle Sankey asks, what would you recommend for a beginner to start out with for a larger variety of shots?
I think a prime lens is key as a still photographer to have. So I think if you have a full sensor or a crop sensor, the 50 1.4, I would go up to at least a 1.4, which it runs about $350. The 1.8 is about $110, but it's not built as well as the 1.4. And the 1.2 is just, it's $1,300. And for me, I couldn't justify. There's a plane fare in that budget along with the lens. So I went with the 1.4, the compromise in between. I would say that's a great lens to work with. I would say if you're ever wanting to buy a telephoto lens, go for quality. and save up your money. Don't cheap out and buy a cheaper zoom lens or telephoto lens. Go with a brand that's known for their glass and wide angle. It depends on what you're shooting, you know, what kind of moves you and what you want to shoot.
So Cassandra Richardson wants to know, what other countries have you visited and done similar projects, and do you have a favorite place that you've visited?
Well, actually, I could send you to my site, ellynism.com, and you can look at the International Travel Gallery and see some of the countries there. I still have to upload. I was in Greece and Turkey and back to Italy recently as well. I'm updating my site to include video, so I'm kind of redoing the site, but you could go see my travel blog. I can't say one particular place. There's places that resonate for sure. Japan. I absolutely love Japan. I loved Cambodia. I loved Bhutan and Nepal. So there's a lot of Asian countries that were interesting in every way. I love Italy. And I'd have to say my top is Iceland. And it's kind of ironic because, you know, I'm from Halifax, Nova Scotia. That's a four-hour direct flight. I mean, Iceland Air flies to my hometown. And it took me this long to get there. And now that I'm way down in California, it's a little further of a trek for me. But I have a real affinity to the place there for many reasons. The food, the people, the horses, not necessarily in that order. And, of course, the beautiful landscape that it's, I mean, could you imagine drinking out of any stream, essentially? There's no pollution. They have geothermal energy that they use to heat their houses. You know, you're showering and drinking out of tap water that's pre-industrialized world water, like glacier water. So there's a lot of really beautiful things about Iceland right now that the rest of our world doesn't offer. So I would say Iceland stands out. There's no place I can tell you that I didn't like. I you know, was intrigued by many things about all the countries I visited. So,
Shannon Puckett wants to know if you have any plans to go on another trip soon, and where will it be, and what inspires you
to go to the different place? Well, I'm still working on that Faith in the Landscape series, but my goal, and this will be third time is charm, my plans to go late spring to Tibet. I've tried to get in twice. I've been denied entry and ended up in Nepal and Bhutan and then China. So I'm hoping I'll get there. I think the people and the landscape in Tibet would be a fascinating place to go as well. So that's what I'm aiming for. Another place that I really would like to visit is Myanmar, Bag in Myanmar, the temples there. And to represent other different religions, I'll have to go to different countries as well. There's an island called Socotra Island and as a part of Yemen, but politically it's not safe for me to go there right now. So that would be like, if you want to Google Socotra Island, you'll see why Ellen wants to go there. But I'm going to have to wait till it's safer. So Africa's a continent I haven't been to, and South America. So lots of opportunities. Next one, likely Tibet.
Okay. Richard Valentine says he sees that you have a site, a section on your site devoted to architecture. Is there anywhere that comes to mind in San Diego as a special place to visit for architectural photography?
San Diego, not too much. I think LA is a lot more interesting. I live in North County. I'm in San Diego for the beaches and the mountains, like, because I'm a nature person. So but architecture that I've been paid to do, there's a lot of houses, you know, just, you know, affluent houses in Rancho Santa Fe. The downtown core is getting built up in San Diego, the Gas Lamp District, Little Italy. I mean, it depends on your focus in architecture as well and what you want to show, the, you know, the ambience of the architecture, the people that interact in the architecture, or just structures. And if structures are what you're after, I think there are a lot more better cities in the world, like Dubai, for instance, to visit for that type of work.
Okay, Shoshana Tompkins wants to know if you ever shoot any 35 millimeter or any film cameras still.
Actually, I do. The one that you saw me on the horse, the emulation shot, was shot with black and white T-Max 400. And I spent some time, which I didn't mention, in the dark room before I went to Iceland with some alternative processes and reprinting some older negatives that I had because I had some time just to go back in the dark room again. So I wanted the emulation shot to be more authentic, so it was on film.
There are several questions as well about just how you plan your work. Do you pre-plan and envision the shots you want? And then how long does it take to get the perfect shot that you want?
Absolutely. Remember my term called Duchamin's term that I use called plan spontaneity. I do plan, and I have an idea journal. And if I give any advice to anyone, have an idea journal so that you can go ahead and store up your ideas. We're all busy working, and people with children and other activities in our lives. Often ideas come to us that we're not able to bring to fruition at that particular point. So I think it's crucial to have yourself a little notebook. Find a little notebook that you can draw and write in and keep your ideas. Because this grid idea that I was working on actually came from my idea journal. And it was an opportunity to explore it when I had a bit of time. So keep your ideas because they tend to fall out of our heads. We're so, busy and so on.
Couple people want to know if you can
do how long does it take to get a shot? Sometimes it's just a matter of just you see it and you know it. And that was true with film too. When you capture something, you got the right light, the right contrast, everything works. But often when you do location photography, you can Google areas all you want. And Google Maps has little satellite pictures that you can go in and look at areas. But until you're there and you experience the light and the intensity and the drama of places, you may not know. And that's why it's important to warm up to subjects and get as many different approaches to locations as possible so that when you go back, and I don't know if this has happened to any of you, but it's happened to me. I've looked at images like months after I've taken them and gone back through my catalogs and found images. I'm like, wow, that's the one, So sometimes you really have to, all the time, you really have to get a variety of different shots because what you end up choosing depends upon it in your editing.
Okay, thanks. Michael Berg and a couple of other people have asked if you do any workshops, and I'm not sure if you could clarify, Michael. Do you mean does she take any workshops or lead any workshops to help her prepare? So we'll wait to hear from Michael on that. And then Andrea Shinzi says, have you ever worked for or considered working for a magazine such as National Geographic or any other travel magazines? Where have you had your photos published? Hello? Ellyn, can you hear me? Okay, it looks like we might be having some audio issues. I know there's several other questions that have come in. I will make sure that Ellyn gets a copy of the question list, and she is available on the Photography Student Professional Network. You can chat with her more there, as well as some of you I know are in her classes. And I want to thank everyone for joining the webinar tonight and hearing all about Ellyn's project and her different experiences with her travel photography, her time-based media, and her salsa dancing. So thank you so much, Ellyn, and thank you everyone for attending.